Well, good morning, church. Woohoo! Are we there? Awesome! Yay! Well, good morning. My name is Ashley, and I just want to take a minute to welcome you here to Monta Vista Chapel. Whether you're joining us here in person today or you are online, we are so excited that we get to gather together and be together today. Over the course of the last few months, we've been talking about our rhythm and our rhythm of gather. And one of the reasons why we love to come together and gather is because we can celebrate and remember what God has done. And so with that, I have been coming off of a crazy week of VBS and recovering from VBS. But we just want to thank everyone who had participated and for all of our volunteers and our many, many kids that were here. We had about 130 kids for VBS this year, over 30 volunteers, and our kids worked really hard at raising money for Love Justice International and raised over $1,100 doing amazing things through VBS. And so we just want to share that with you all today, and I have a video for you guys to recap our time in VBS this last week. So as you can see, VBS is never a dull moment, and we just had a great time. And so I just want to just remind you that as we get ready to open our hearts to worship this morning, that you just remember and celebrate what God has done throughout the week this week. If you would please stand with us. Thank you.
with gratitude to respond to just the ways that you have been present with us, Father. And so today, would you just imprint the memories of where you've been, not only in your big picture story, Father, but also in our own stories. Would you imprint those memories on our hearts, God, so that we would never forget, that we could remember, and then be in this place together, Father, with you together. So God, may it be not then, not when, but now, that we could be present in the fullness of the life that you have for us. That we wouldn't spend time dwelling in the past, but remembering and celebrating. That we wouldn't spend time worrying about the future, but anticipating you showing up to be with us. So God, that's our prayer today, now. That we would become aware, that we would know you different, and that we would tell the story, that we could share how you move in us and in our families and in our neighborhoods and our community, God, that we would know so deeply how you love us.
Me. You put all God, that's something we need to be reminded of today, that you are faithful. And that faithfulness is not dependent upon anything, just simply your character. And so in the midst of our unfaithfulness, in the midst of our wandering, in the midst of us being consumed with so many lesser things, you remain faithful. And so this morning I pray, God, as we continue in worship through story, in worship through your word, God, may we be drawn back to you, the one who has never changed, the one who is always present, who is always there. Great is your faithfulness, God. We give you praise in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Well, you may be seated. You may be seated. It's great to be together, isn't it? Yeah. And it's good to have Chris back from sabbatical. Welcome, Chris. Yeah. Wonderful. We always have the opportunity to be able to share a little bit about our shared rhythm of life. As a church, we talk about the fact that we gather, we give, and we serve, and we go, and we try to highlight that weekly. And so this week, Brad Smith is going to come up, and he's going to share a little bit about serving, because I don't know, he's one of those guys who consistently serves. So Brad, would you share with us?
I wanted to share a little bit with you first about how when my children were young, I have two children and they're up there, and I had to change diapers. I constantly was changing diapers, it felt like. But I would start by playing with their feet, making eye contact, and as they got older, and you'd go for the smile, and then later the giggle, and then the laugh, and you would try and build that relationship. I would make up songs, and I'm not very good, but it doesn't matter when you're with a little child. And you make up songs, and you try and go like, ooh, stinky poo-poo, or whatever, to make them laugh and make joy and make that contact, because that relationship and that building of the relationship makes the mess okay to deal with, right? And it makes that service doable. And that's what service is about, really, is about relationship. I've had the opportunity to serve God in so many ways, and pretty much actively since I was 14, and I'm 48 now, so that's about 38 years of service in different ways. Service that has taken me to live in countries of extreme cold and taken me to live in countries of extreme heat. I've had the blessed opportunity of being thanked by the Secretary of Education for Mali. Like, I've had all these opportunities. I've got to live in mud huts. I've got to do all kinds of things. And I get to do things here. I get to serve in True Clubs and in Children's Church. But I also get to work here. And I get to clean. And I get to clean up after you. And that's service, too. And sometimes it's difficult when there's mess. You know, sometimes I got to pray to God, help me not to hurl as I deal with certain issues or certain things. But again, service to God is all about relationship, and especially to God, it's relationship up here. And it starts up here, and then it moves out here. It starts up here, and then it moves out here. And that's the thing, and you build that, and in times of struggle where you don't want to show up, where you've already been working and struggling, and you don't want to come to True Clubs that night, or you don't want to deal with sixth graders and things like that. What keeps you going is that relationship here and then the relationship out here, because it's all about relationship, even when it seems like it's not, even when all you're doing is pulling trash. It's still about relationship. And there's so many opportunities, not just here, all over, I'm sure, within your life. There's so many opportunities to serve. And I just want to encourage you to do that, because I want to remind you that while we take the bread and the cup and we think about those things, before Christ initiated that, he took a towel and he wrapped it around his waist. And he took some water and he got down on his hands and knees. And you can read this in John 13. He got down on his hands and knees and he washed his disciples' feet. He humbled himself and he washed his disciples' feet. We have a God who is a servant. He is a servant, and he gave us that example. And that's a blessed thing, because that also helps us, you know, in the ups and downs. We have a God who understands, who's washed the nasty feet and dealt with it and did it freely out of his own desire. So that's what I want to share with you. Thank you.
Brad, I think we could probably just say amen and go home. After that, I do want to publicly acknowledge Brad. He's the head of our custodial department, and he's the guy who, when you show up, everything's the way it's supposed to be, and it is a huge ministry here at Monta Vista. So, Brad, thank you so, so much. It is one of the most thankless jobs on our campus, and so, Brad, thank you so much, and for serving in so many ways, and for the model that you give us for serving. I also, one of our shared rhythms is to give, and I also just want to stop for a moment and remind us that as we come together, even though we're not passing a plate, we still practice giving financially, and you can do that in multiple ways. You can do that on the church app if you have that. On the seat back in front of you, you have a little QR code, and if you check that out, it'll take you to a giving page. It'll also take you to a place where you can get connected and gather, and where you can also ask for prayer requests. So we want to invite you to do that. You can also give as you leave. If you are the less technologically minded and like the traditional check or paper money or whatever, you can drop that off as you leave in the exits. But before we continue, I'd like to just pray for the offering that we are giving, both of our service, of our finances, as we continue on. So God, we are so grateful for what you have given us, your faithfulness. And as Brad said, you are a servant, and so in response we serve. And you are a giver, and in response we give. So God, soften our hearts, do the work you need to do in us, so that you can work through us. God, and I pray that you would bless not only the service, but also the financial gifts that allow the ministry of this group of people to be spread throughout the world. We're grateful for that. God, would you bless it and multiply it? Use it to advance your kingdom. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Well, today we are going to continue our sermon series called Wise Guys, where we are walking through the Old Testament minor prophets. And if you have been with us for a while through this series, you know that it can be a bit sobering, right? It can be a bit sobering because the reality is these prophets, through the minor prophets, we are confronted with what happens when a group of people continually, like, turn away from God. We're confronted with what happens with a group of people who won't return to the loving God who created them, and things just don't turn out well. In fact, by the time we get to Hosea, our minor prophet for the week, by the time we get to Hosea, things are so bad that there are four prophets actively speaking God's judgment against both the northern tribes of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. They're trying to kind of help them see the error of their ways and to bring them back to God. The leaders of both the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom were in a full-on free fall. Their people were spiraling into chaos. And so four prophets were speaking. We had Amos, who we've already talked about, right? You remember Amos didn't have a whole lot of hope. Like only five verses in the whole book had any sense of hope. And then we had Micah, who talked about bringing justice and mercy, especially to those who are poor and who are marginalized. And then we have the prophet Isaiah, who's teaching now. He's a major prophet, not a minor prophet. But we've gone through a good portion of the book of Isaiah a few years back. And then today we have the prophet Hosea. And all of them were confronting Israel and Judah's hypocrisy, their idolatry, and their continued neglect for those who were poor and for those who were marginalized. And I was reflecting on just this reality, that there are four prophets that are trying to draw Israel back to God. I wonder today how many prophets God might need to send to the church. How much does God feel it necessary to address our hypocrisy, where our actions don't match up with our words? How much does God need to address our idolatry, our preoccupation with wealth and with pleasure and with power? How much does our God need to address our struggles with overlooking the poor and the marginalized and those who need God's grace most? How many prophets would God need to send to the church today? I just think it's a sobering reality for us to reflect on. Like I said, journeying through the minor prophets can be a sobering reality. So much so that in the midst of all of this prophetic judgment, it's easy to miss what is most true about God. In fact, I have a friend who listens online quite a bit. Hi, George, if you're listening. Who really wrestles a great deal with the anger and judgment of God in the Old Testament. It's a real struggle for him. And as I've said, I struggle with that as well. But friends, what's most true about God is not his judgment. What is most true about God is not wrath and anger. What is most true about God is his unfailing love. What's most true about God is his faithfulness that we sang about. His faithfulness in the midst of our unfaithfulness. All throughout Scripture, we see that that's God's desire. His desire is that his most beloved creation, that's you and me and all the rest of humanity, that all of us would return to God, and that we would find the flourishing life that we were created to experience. That's God's heart. That has always been God's heart. And a very short trip through biblical history will point that out very clearly. And we start with Adam and Eve, and though they were provided with the most flourishing environment you could possibly imagine, they still turned away from God to try to make a better life for themselves, and they were in the Garden of Eden. They tried to make a better life for themselves on their own, and it went sideways, but God did not abandon them. In fact, in Genesis chapter 3:15, we see immediately that God sets out and puts a plan together to restore Adam and Eve and all of their descendants. And the way he did that was by choosing one of their descendants, Abraham. He said, Abraham, I'm going to bless you so that you can be a blessing to the world. And wouldn't you know it? Abraham was not faithful either. And yet God remained faithful, despite Abraham and his descendants not being faithful. So much so that they found themselves in slavery in Egypt. And they cried out, God, would you deliver us? And God did not turn a deaf ear. He didn't say, well, you made your bed, you just lie in it. No, he actively stepped in. He freed them from Egypt and brought them into the promised land, a land that Scripture said was flowing with milk and honey. But even inside of the promised land, we see that God's people would not be faithful. In fact, the cycle of walking away from God was so common that biblical scholars have given it a name. It's called the decline deliverance cycle. In other words, the people of God would walk away from God and they would decline. They would find themselves enslaved or they'd find themselves in a mess and they'd cry out to God. God would hear their cry and he would come and deliver them and it would be good for a while and then they'd start the whole cycle over and over again. And that decline and deliverance cycle continued all the way through the kings of Israel up to the day where we have our minor prophet of the week, Hosea, prophesying. And what's interesting is few other books in Scripture portray God's faithfulness more than the book of Hosea. So today's story is a story of tremendous hope. Because we need that hope, don't we? Friends, hear this clearly. God does not give up. He does not give up on us. He does not give up on you. In fact, the word that best describes God's character in the Old Testament is the Hebrew word chesed. Now, chesed is a difficult word to translate because it is so packed with meaning. But as one biblical scholar said, it is about the completely undeserved generosity and kindness of God towards humanity. It is about the completely undeserved generosity and kindness of God towards humanity. The prophet Isaiah, one of the prophets who was prophesying during this time of Hosea, speaks of this chesed love in Isaiah 54:10. You may be familiar with it. The prophet writes, "Though the mountains be shaken and though the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love, my chesed, will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you." And this morning, we're going to take a look at that unfailing love that's shown to us through the book of Hosea. I want to begin close to the end of the book and read a few verses out of Hosea chapter 11. I think they so beautifully express God's chesed love. Here Hosea writes, or speaking on God's behalf, says, "When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. But the more they were called, the more they went away from me. They sacrificed to the Baals, and they burned incense to images. It was I who taught Ephraim to walk, taking them by the arms. But they did not realize it was I who healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with ties of love. To them, I was like one who lifts a little child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them." And then at verse 8, God continues and says, "How can I give up on you, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? How can I treat you like Admah? How can I make you like Zeboiim? My heart is changed within me. All my compassion is aroused. I will not carry out my fierce anger, nor will I devastate Ephraim again, for I am God and not a man, the Holy One among you." Friends, we must not let the judgment of the minor prophets distract us from what is most true about God, and that is his chesed, God's unfailing love in the midst of all of our failings. So God chooses to communicate that in a very unique way through the prophet Hosea, very unique in a very pointed way. In the first four chapters of this book, God calls Hosea to be a living parable. A parable is an anecdote that points to God's character or who he is. Well, God says, "Hosea, you're going to be a living parable." And he does this by instructing Hosea to marry a promiscuous woman, a woman by the name of Gomer, who most probably was someone who was being exploited as a cult prostitute. So God was asking Hosea to be faithful to an unfaithful spouse. I want you to think about that. To be faithful to an unfaithful spouse so that Hosea might understand the deep love that God has for his unfaithful people. Now, before I continue, I need to make something very clear, especially in our day and age. This living parable is in no way a commentary on genders. In other words, men are not innately more religious and holy and righteous than women, and women are not more innately seductive or sexual or easily tempted. In fact, a close reading of the text suggests that Hosea was probably not faithful to Gomer early on in their marriage. And we see that in Hosea 3:3, for when they're reconciled, Hosea has to pledge himself to be faithful to her. And then there are realities of very redeeming qualities in Gomer. I mean, the reality is we see that Gomer nurtures her children. And she does so when they have been given awful names. names that mean terrible things, like you're not loved, you're not my people. And yet she nurtured them, and biblical scholars say it's a beautiful image of God's deep love for us. So in this living parable is not about gender, though I've heard it preached that way. Rather, it is about God's endless love for humanity. It is about God's chesed, despite our tendency to wander away from God again and again and again. So as I've said, in order to communicate this unfailing love, God instructs Hosea to marry Gomer, a promiscuous woman, so that Hosea would be able to understand and hopefully actually begin to live out the kind of love that God was showing for humanity. And in chapter 1, we see that they have three children. And all three children are given names to help us begin to see what the Israelites will experience if they do not turn back to God. The first one's name is Jezreel, which kind of brings us back to a point in history that reminds us that God sets things straight and that there will be judgment. The second child, a daughter, was named Loruhamah, which means not loved. Could you imagine that? And the third child, a son, was named Lo-Ami, which meant not my people. So God is obviously painting this picture to the Israelites, this living picture that says this is what it's going to be like if you don't turn back to me. Your life will continue to spiral and spiral out of control. And then as we continue this living parable, sometime after the weaning probably of her third child, Gomer returned to her previous way of life. She went back into what most probably was temple prostitution. Now, Scripture doesn't give us a reason for that, but there are many who have speculated, and I tend to agree, it was because Hosea did not really love Gomer with the kind of chesed love that God had displayed to Israel. Rather, Hosea could not get over his contempt for Gomer's sin. He disdained her past because it tainted his present reputation. So some suggests that Gomer was driven back to promiscuity because the love of a self-righteous prophet was no better than the love of the men who had purchased her. And church, we need to sit with that for a little bit. The love of a self-righteous prophet is no better than the love of the men who purchased her. So once again, God instructs Hosea, like, go after her. Go, you need to go buy her back. And because Gomer had sold herself into slavery, it meant that he, Hosea, a righteous man, a prophet of God, had to publicly go across the square into the pagan temple and bid on his own wife to buy her back. You can imagine the humiliation he felt. And it would have been only a fraction of the humiliation that God probably feels as he returns again and again and again to our own unfaithfulness. So Hosea went to the market and he bought Gomer back for 15 shekels of silver and for a homer and lethek of barley. And the last we hear of Gomer and Hosea is that they committed themselves to be faithful to one another. We don't know how the story ends, except we really do. Because, friends, the truth is, Hosea is simply an introduction to another story. It's the introduction to a story of a God who sees the one he loves, you, me, the rest of humanity. He sees the one he loves. And despite our ongoing unfaithfulness, despite our hypocrisy, despite our preoccupation with the lesser gods of pleasure and of power and of wealth, and despite our lack of care for those who God seems to care most about, the poor and the marginalized, God, compelled by chesed, humbled himself and became one of us. Like the prophet Hosea, God put on clothes and traipsed through the public square to buy us back. Only it didn't cost God simply 15 shekels of silver and a homer and a lithak of barley. It cost God his very life. It cost Jesus his own life. Friends, we hear that story all the time, but we need to be reminded of the depth of God's chesed love for us. See, Jesus was despised. He was rejected. He was denied and he was betrayed by those who were supposed to love him most. And in a very ironic twist, like Gomer, he was sold for a bag of silver. But through it all, Jesus continued to love. In fact, when things were worst, when he was hanging on a cross and he received all of our hatred, all of our sin, all of our betrayal, all of our anger, all of our violence, all of our vengeance, all of our retribution, because friends, that's what put Jesus on the cross. As he received that, he displayed chesed in the most amazing way possible. He forgave us. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Friends, forgiveness is the form love must take in a broken world. And that is the extent of God's love for you. That's the extent of God's love for me. That in the midst of our unfaithfulness, God faithfully demonstrates his love by giving his own life. That is what is most true about God. It always has been. It always will be. That is the faithfulness that we return to and we praise God for and we sing. And that's what our minor prophet, Hosea, wants us to know this week. So then what are we to do with this? And what are we to do with this chesed love? How do we respond to a God whose love for us has no limit? Well, probably a lot of ways, but I just want to take a look at two of them. First, I believe it invites us to ask ourselves if and how our love reflects the chesed love of God. Does my love reflect the chesed love of God, the unfailing love? Because, friends, I think it's important for us to ask that question in our current culture. Because today our culture seems to cancel anyone for the smallest of infractions. We don't see eye to eye, well, you're canceled. If there is any sense of betrayal or hurt, we just get up and walk away. I'm not a big social media guy, but I see these little phrases that come across that say, like, people aren't worth your pain. Just walk away. Man, there is nothing less biblical than that. And yet we, as Christians, buy into that reality. Now, please, I do understand there are places where we must draw boundaries in relationships. And there are times where we must walk away for our own safety and for our own health. And the truth is the church has not always been good at helping people establish and enforce those types of boundaries. At the same time, though, I am concerned that our society's ability to truly love one another, and in that, the church's ability to truly love one another, is growing thinner and thinner, because love is not forged in easy spaces. Love is not strengthened when we all get along perfectly. Love is proven, and it is deepened when it is tested. And if we just walk away, we will never learn to love. And unless we learn to love, we won't experience the flourishing that God has created us for. Because it's not just about being able to get along with everybody because we all think the same. It's being able to actually love people who are different than us. Personally, I'm profoundly grateful for being able to stay in the same community as a pastor. That's a very unusual thing. So thank you for your patience for nearly 30 years. But I'm grateful for staying in one place because it is here in this community that my ability to love has been strengthened. Because as I've shared before, it's in this community that I have been hurt and I have hurt others. It is in this community that I have been betrayed and I have been the betrayer. And if I had just walked away, I would have not learned to love. If others would just walk away, we as a community wouldn't learn to love. But it's in staying in it that I learn the deep chesed love of God as I experience forgiveness and as I learn to forgive. It's there where we learn the deep work of reconciliation with one another that teaches us to love. It gets beyond the feeling of love to the actual substance of love. It's in the staying that love is proven and strengthened. So, how does your love for one another stack up against God's chesed love for you? Are you quick to walk away, to dismiss someone, to cancel them? Or are you willing to stay in it and learn to love as God loves you, and not just to tolerate, not just to put up, but to love? That's the first question that I think our prophet Hosea forces us to wrestle with. How are we loving? And that question is rooted in the second question we need to wrestle with, which is how often are you returning to the chesed love that God has for you? How often are you returning to the chesed love that God has for you? Because I'm going to say what I so often say from this podium. We cannot give away what we do not have. We are conduits, not generators. So as you examine your own love in light of God's chesed love, know the only way that you are going to be able to grow and to love well is if you continually return to God and receive his love. It's not just something you did once. It is something that we do again and again and again. I think that's why the Apostle Paul tells us to continue to work out our salvation. I think that's what it is returning back in the midst of our brokenness back to the love of God. This afternoon, I'm going to be leading the 10th of 12 gatherings of the Journey, which is our year-long discipleship and formation process that we do. And we're 10 months in, and this will be the first week that we begin to make an outward turn to help people consider what it is to love others. And why does it take so long? Because we have to first learn to receive love. And that's hard for us. We have to learn to be anchored in the love of the Trinity. We need to be convinced that we are God's beloved sons and daughters. And then we have to deal with the brokenness that gets in the way of us receiving and ultimately giving that love away. And then when we do that and we cooperate with God's work in us, then we're able to love others. So Monte Vista Chapel, do you have an established rut back to the chesed love of God? Do you have an established rut? A way that you personally know how to return back to the chesed love of God. When you are hurt or betrayed or let down or disappointed, do you get lost in that? Or are you able to hear God's invitation to return to him and find that rut back to him so that you can see clearly and know how to engage in a loving way? And if you don't have that regular way to return to God's love, please understand it is understandable. Like, it's not always an easy thing to do. And I want you to know that there are many people who would love to walk alongside of you and discover it. Because it is something that does need to be discovered, because it's different for each one of us. And quite frankly, it's different for us in different seasons of our lives. And the truth is, we cannot do this on our own. Even if we've encountered it, I still need people in my life to remind me and point me back to the love of God. I can't tell you how many times close spiritual friends, when I'm in the midst of a mess, will ask a question that I should have already thought of, which is simply, have you returned to God? No. Thanks for the reminder. Return to the love of God. So if you want to find people, I mean, you can find them anywhere, but if you want to find a high concentration of them, there's people who have gone through the journey. You can find them there. We're doing a new cohort called The Table, and that's going to be starting in the fall. Guaranteed, we will grow and learn together how to do that. We have a marriage ministry called Reengage, sorry. Man, my brain went out the window. Called Reengage, and it's a great place where you will encounter people who know how to point you back to the love of God. You can talk to an elder or a staff member, but know that you will not be able to love others unless you have a reliable rut back to the love of God. I know of no other way. And the more of us who learn how to do that, the more our community will experience the love of God through us. And that's always been God's plan, right? Through Adam and Eve. It is God's plan through Abraham, through Moses, through the judges and the kings, through our wise guys, the minor prophets, and ultimately through Jesus, and now through Jesus in us to the world. Let me pray. God, we are grateful for the depth of your love, for an unfailing love. And God, we know that when we walk away from that, the world starts to come unglued. And yet, something in us just doesn't want to turn back. So God, I ask that through your Holy Spirit, you would draw us back to yourself. That we would be reminded that anyone who turns to you will never see the face of a judgmental or angry God. They will see your love and your grace and your forgiveness, your truth. We will certainly see correction and discipline, but it's based so deeply in your love. So God, would you turn us back to you, and may we receive that chesed love, both for ourselves, because we need it, but the rest of the world needs it as well, and we can only give away what you've given us. So God, may you make this our deep desire to receive from you your faithful love, and then give it away to those around us. God, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, thanks for being here. I want to invite you to stand up, and we're going to receive the parting blessing. Remind you that if you've come prepared to give, you can drop things off at the giving boxes at each of the exits. So would you receive God's parting blessing? Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, both now and for all generations. Amen. Go in God's grace and peace.